Hi, this is Anushka and welcome back to another tutorial in the OpenCV playlist. Now, I know that I'm a bit late in uploading this video, but I can definitely assure you that it's gonna be totally worth it. If you have gone through the title, you know what we're building today. We've all worked with SATs, we've given ACTs, we've given multiple Olympiads, and we know that this thing stays constant in like all of them. So today, we're gonna be automating the process of actually building this entire scanner from scratch and evaluating all the answers based on whatever response we got from the user. So first of all, thanks to Pyramid Search for providing us with this excellent scanned sheet. I guess it's Photoshop, but still. And we'll be using this for our reference and we'll be building an entire scanner around this document. You'll find the piece of code in my GitHub repo, so feel free to clone that. Alright, so getting started with the video, first of all, I have already created a folder named grader right here, and I'm gonna import my 4-point transform file. Now, if you don't know what this file is, I'd really appreciate if you could go back to the previous videos and check that out, because we've talked about in depth and a lot of detail about what this does, and that will be useful in the later part of the video. So I'm just gonna put it in my grader folder, and this .png file, that is my OMR sheet right here, and let's open it up in VS Studio Code. Inside my grader.py directory, and let's start by quickly importing all the required packages. So first package that I import is cv2, another package is numpy, I'm gonna be importing it as mp just like always. Then importing immutils, because this is going to do the most of the heavy lifting for us. And if we have imported immutils, from immutils we will also import our contours, because we'll be dealing with a lot of contour detection on this particular image, you know, getting every shapes out of the image and processing it. This becomes very important and a major necessity while we're actually building a scanner. And another thing which we need to import is our 4-point transform method right over here. So yeah, let's import it as well inside our file. And there you go. So having imported all the packages, I am gonna quickly take a variable name answer key. So as the name suggests, this is gonna be our dictionary format of every answers and however we want it to be created, all right? So my first question will be marked at a zero index, because indexing in Python starts from zero. My second question, that is the first question, will have an answer as the fifth element or the E, because this has like A, B, C, D and E. So we have like five parameters, so we can go up till four. All right, then my third question, that will be my second question, will be marked zero, like that the first answer or the eighth answer is correct. And let's say for the third answer, the third one is correct. And for the fourth, it's the fifth one. So that is in total of five. So, you know, question number one will have A as the correct answer. Question number two will have D. Question number three, and so on. We've initialized the answer key. Now let's start by reading the image. So using cv2's imread method, we're gonna read in the image. So which image are we gonna work with? That's the OMR one. So let's pass in the relative path of this particular, or you know, the address of this particular image right here. If at any point you are not able to understand or translate that what that particular code is doing, I can ensure you can go check out the previous videos, because we've talked about each and every function in details. We've even worked with multiple projects on the same function, so that can be a great help for you. For now, I'm not gonna go in a lot of details about the stuff we've discussed previously for the sake of complexity, for not complicating it enough. Alright, so now I have read the image using the image function using OpenCV. Now let's translate the image to grayscale. We know how we do that. cv2.cvt color property right there. And what all arguments do we need to pass in? We need to pass in the image right over here and the property that it needs to be converted, cv2.color _bgr2gray. Right, so this will display our image in a grayscale. The image is converted to grayscale. If you want, you can, you know, use a I'm show method to actually see the image, but we're gonna just keep it for now. After converting the image to grayscale, we actually need to smoothen it out. So for that, I take another variable that is blurred, and using the Gaussian blur property of OpenCV, I'm gonna smoothen this image out to remove all the noises present in the image. Now, that cannot be done on a colored image, and hence it was important to convert the image to two channels, that is black and white, or in other words, to grayscale. So we pass in our gray attribute. What do they do? What are the sizes? You can refer to it right over here, also in the previous video. But for now, let's just, you know, start by blurring it out. If at any point you feel like you need to see the results, or if everything is working fine, you can just go and check out the dogs in the previous video. Particular image out, we need to find the edges of this particular image, or that one particular line joining this entire boundary. So, you know, finding out the boundaries, we take another variable named as edged, and using CV2's canny edge detection algorithm, we're gonna pass in the blurred image and another attributes, so that we can finally get an edged image before actually moving further. So CV2.imshow, let's see how my image looks up till now. It is our edged image, right? So let's pass in edge over here and the variable. Now using the weight key, let's run this file to check what output does it give. And there you go. Previously observed that we got all the edges around the image. That is, you know, it's more like a rough outline. What we need to do is get back to finding all the contours, all right, all the main contours around this image, and then further ensure that we are getting the right question contour out of all the contours we extracted. So for that, let's take another variable, all right, and let's name it CNTS, short for contours, and using CV2's find contours function, we're gonna pass in the edged image right over here, because we're gonna be finding contours in the edged image itself, and having a retrieval mode that is retrieval x. We have multiple retrieval modes, as you can see. You have list, you have tree. It depends upon what kind of contours do you want, like all of them, or do you want some specific contours, or following the parent child hierarchy, that you want contours inside the file and contours inside of it, and you want like the coordinate points of all the contours. But for now, we just gonna work with method external. And another attribute we're gonna pass here is our chain approximation. So we're gonna keep it simple. That means we just want the outer boundaries of all the contours we've got. And then using immutals grab contour method, we're gonna get all the contours in the variable and all the coordinate axes henceforth required. Alright, so this CNTS will have a list of all the contours present in the document, but what we are concerned is with the document contour. Alright, we don't need each of these contours, or you know, this and everything that follows. We're just concerned with this rectangle piece of paper, which is gonna be our main contour. So let's just call it doc contour, short for document contour, and so this is our doc contour, and let's just for now keep it none, because we haven't, you know, actually found it yet. So after further processing, we can actually get back to it. All right, so now I use a if statement, that the first condition for finding the doc contour is that we should at least find one contour before anything. So this loops only get executed if we ensure that we have one contour in the image the user provided. And now what we need to do is sort these contours in descending order. Why are we doing that? Because we are assuming that the very first or the biggest contour that satisfies a particular conditions of being a rectangle or a square is going to be our gradient answer sheets. Alright, so we are going to use a CV2 sorted method, passing in all the contours. Now, another parameter which this need is a key. So, key is on what parameters do you want these contours to be sorted? So, for now, we are mainly dealing with area. So, we want the contours to be sorted according to their particular area. So, using CV2's contour area method, that will be our key. So, key is equals to CV2.contourArea. And again, reverse equals to 2 because we don't want them to be sorted in ascending order. Rather, we want the biggest contour to be on the first and then smaller contours followed by that. Okay, now that being done, let's iterate over each contour we got. Alright, so for C in CNTS, we now need to approximate the rectangle or the square contours. Why do we need to do that? Because as you have seen from the edge demos, they were not proper rectangles, all right, after edge detection. So we need to be okay with everything which is very near to being a rectangle. So for that, I take a value perimeter and using CV2's arc-length method right here, I'm going to approximate the values of those contours. So passing in the first contour, that is the first CV found in the contour method. And let's just make it true. You can refer what is being done. We've talked about approximating contours all the time before. And we take another method, that is approx. This is used for approximating those contours. And another method, that is approx polyDB method. And we pass in the contour. Here we use an experimental value for the arc length. That can be anything. For now, I'm taking this because it worked fine for my code, but it depends on what you're working. This is pretty experimental, so you know you can increase or decrease the values to check what works the best for you. And then we find all the three arguments. So this is basically returning us a figure or the first contour, which is having an approximate, you know, length arc or perimeter. So after that, now that we have that, what we need to check if the length of the approximate contour which we received previously, it should be equal to 4, because we are dealing with a quadrilateral, so it has like 4 sides, and we need to ensure that if the length of that particular contour is 4, it has 4 points around the axis. You know, we initialized doc cnt is equals to none. Right here, the value of doc cnt becomes approx. That means we have gained or we have found our document contour. So we can just simply break out of the loop because we know what is our region of interest or ROI, and we can move on further. So I break out of the loop. Alright, now that I have the coordinates of the paper, we can go deeper. But before doing that, we need a bird's eye view, or as I'd say, we have to use our 4-point transformation method, because this is having a lot of unnecessary things which we do not need. Moreover, we want this paper to be viewed from a top angle rather than a slight angle. Alright, so for that, I have already imported my 4-point method. And I call it right over here. I take another variable known as paper, and importing my 4-point transform method, 4-point.4-point transform. All right, I am gonna pass in my image right over here. That is the image we read in the image variable. And whatever the contours of doc, and we're gonna reshape it into a numpy array of 4 by 2. Okay, so let's just run it to check if everything is working fine till now. Yeah, it is. I'm just gonna erase this part so everything is getting called. And okay, so now we take another variable, that is our warped. And here, rather than passing the original image, I'm gonna have it everything's gonna be the same, just for a few changes which I'm gonna do right here. Rather than passing my entire image over here, I'm gonna pass in my grayscale image, okay? and everything is same. And now I'm going to use cv2.imshowProperty. Let's pass in verbed and the variable to see what it shows. And let's use the wait key. Okay. I need to enter 0 over here. Okay, let me remove this else it will throw an error. Okay. Yeah, there you go. As you can see, all the unnecessary, you know, noises and everything which was not in our region of interest has been removed, and it gives us like the document has been scanned from a 90 degree straight angle outside the scanner. So till now, everything is going super smooth. Now that we are done with this, a very important process which we need to follow is the thresholding. That is binarization, or converting the image, or, you know, reducing everything to just two basic standard colors, that is black and white. All right. So for now, we'll be dealing with another technique, which is Otsu's binarization. We've worked with threshold. We've known what that is. But, you know, there is another kind of threshold which we're going to incorporate right here. Like I said, that's Otsu. We're going to pass in our warped image over here, a parameter, and whatever the color we want for our image. And another additional parameter which you might have not seen in the previous video is this one, thresh binary inv, and cv2.threshotsu. So what this does is, in every image which is a bimodal image or have two peaks in the histogram, it is not okay to approximate every values above a point to one particular value and everything beyond that to something else, because it has two peaks. So we deal with finding out the medium or the average values between the two peaks of the histogram. You want to read about it, you can check out the documentation to see what kind of results is it gonna return. Alright, and there you go. So here is the properly thresholded image. Now that we have received the thresholded image, we can easily detect the question contours or the bubble contours inside this particular image, which makes it very easy for us to further detect the correct bubbles after we have detected all of these bubbles from this rectangle sheet of paper. Alright, so for that, let's hop over to our editor and I'm gonna comment these out. Alright, so first of all, for finding the contours, we are gonna use contour detection again on the threshold images. So using cv2's find contour method. Okay, I forgot to mention that. cv2.findContour method. Let me pass in my thresh image. My retrieval method, that is gonna be retrieval external. And then let me pass in I chain approximation. We've used this so many times, so I am sure you guys understand what this function does. Okay, so this gives us all the contours, and now we need these contours sorted and properly arranged. So for that, I'm gonna use immutils grab contour method to pass in, and it returns us all the contours associated with the image. All right so I have my contours right here, and now I'm gonna take a list and name is question cnt. So for now, it's an empty list because we do not have any question contours right now with us. But as soon as we detect one, it is going to be appended in this particular list itself. All right. So I am going to loop over all the contours this function returns me. And first thing which I need to do, or I would say two things which we need to do to know that this is our region of interest, is to find the bounding box of the contour, and then using the bounding box to derive the aspect ratio. All right. So aspect ratio is basically the ratio of your width is to your height. And if your contours are sufficiently large, you know, and they have a decent aspect ratio of 1, that means you can assume that the given figure is similar to a circle. and is our region of interest, or find appends to the list of the question counters. All right, so I'm gonna loop over each of these, and let me just take four variables, that is x, y. These are the x, y coordinates, the width coordinate and the height coordinate. And right now I'm gonna use a function, that is CV2's bounding rect function, to detect the bounding rectangle. You can check out the documentation for further understanding, but for now this returns us the coordinates around a definite rectangle. And now what we need to find is the aspect ratio, and that will be equal to your width divided by your float of height. Float, because we are type converting here, so type conversion is basically the conversion of a lower data type to a higher data type. So for now it is int, but we want it to be in specific decimal, so we are using float over here, and I'm passing it height. So this variable AR will have a ratio of my width is to height, or in other words the aspect ratio of that particular image. All right, and now I'm going to use my if statements and apply a condition that if my width is greater than or equal to 20, as well as my height is greater than or equal to 20, or one last parameter, that is the aspect ratio should either be greater than or equal to 0.9. All right, and at the same time in, and the aspect ratio should be less than and equal to 1.1. okay, and if these two conditions are satisfied, you can just simply append the values of the question contour with this particular contour. So for every contour that this particular function encounters in the image, it checks for all the conditions around this contour. Do they have, see, this is also circle, okay, it will also have an aspect ratio of approximately equal to 1, but this is not our question contour because it does not have the required height and the x and y, sorry, the weight and height coordinates of our question counter. So we can simply neglect it. That is why we are having these three checks right over here, so that we have just nothing but the question counters with us. So now that we have actually found a way to grab all these contours, all the circle or the bubble contour from our image, it is important to sort these contours in a proper manner so that we can iterate over each of these following contours and, you know, further get out that which of the circle was bubbled and move on to our evaluation part. But directly we cannot jump on to the evaluation part before we have sorted all the contours. So my question contours get appended in this question.cnt list. All right, so first of all, how I might have this contour as my first contour and this contour as my second contour, or this contour as my first contour and this contour as my second contour. So there are two processes in which I am going to sort these contours. So the first step is to sort these contours right from top to bottom. All right, so my contour starts from here and ends over here. I want these contours to be sorted that way. So that is a very simple step. You can just, you know, take these question contours and using contours dot sort contour method, you can easily, you know, sort these contours right after you pass in the contours that you want to sort. And one additional step which should be added here is your method. So how do we want to sort these contours? We want them to be sorted from top to bottom. All right, so we want that the first contour is on the top and the second contour follows it, just like that. Right, and since we always have a hierarchy involved, let's pass in the zeroth argument. And another thing which we need to do is take another counter, and that is correct. So this means the number of correct answers we found while we were evaluating all the answer sheets. All right, so after sorting my contours from top to bottom, I need to sort these contours from left to right. Okay, and that this sorting the contours from top to bottom can be easily done using the inbuilt method, but for sorting it left to right, there is another piece of logic which we need to involve in here. So right now I am taking Q, I because I'll be iterating over each contour, and I also need the enumerate value of each of the following contours. What is it? We're going to see just in a couple of seconds. So here I take my enumerate function, that is basically in Python to provide us with an iterable object as well as a number corresponding to that particular iterable object, alright? So rather than, you know, just looping over each value in a list, I need a number of sequence to help me loop that value. So first function which I'm going to use is np.arrange. I have already imported my library. So np.arrange actually helps us to give a values in a particular range, okay, sorted values in a particular range. So my question contours has like all the contours, though sorted from top to bottom, but still jumbled up in terms of their horizontal arrangement. So for now, we take in the first value, that is my index should start from point 0, that is my very first contour which you encounter, and it should go to the length of my question contours. Alright, so and another parameter which I need to pass here, that is my third parameter, is the step. Okay, so we all know that this particular image has 1, 2, 3, 4 and 5 bubbles in this sheet. So we want each of these 5 to be sorted in a set of 5, in the batch of 5. Okay, so I use np.arrange function, I pass in the 0th index. The end index is the length of the contour, and we have another value, that is 5, and that is basically the step value. So what is this gonna return? And first of all, a list of 0 to 5, that will be our qth will be the number of how many lists there exist. So that will be 0 for now, and I will have all those 5 elements in the list. Next, the next 5 elements, and that will have an index of 1. Just move in inside the loop, and I'm gonna pass in the same parameters and using the contour dot sort method, the sort contour method, I'm gonna sort these contours. But right now, keeping in mind the indexes with which we need to sort the contour, so the contours needs to be sorted in a batch of 5. All right, so for every row in the bubble sheet, these contours need to be sorted from that particular address. All right, so right now I'm using array slicing, and it should start right from the ith index to I plus 5th index, because if we go to our image, we know that this row has 5 bubbles here, okay, from A to E. So we want them to sort these bubbles first, evaluate the result, then go to next 5, then the next 5, and so on. So this is how we're going to sort the contours. That is, the contours need to be sorted right in the form of left to right, but that will be done on the basis of the values in return, and also the zeroth parameter, because it gives us 2 values. And for now, we have not calculated the bubbled contour. So we assume that the bubble contour is none. So the bubble contour is the contour which has the right answer, or the answer which is not the right answer, but the answer marked by the user. In this case, the second or the first value in the list is going to be a bubbled contour. In this case, the fifth value, and so on. Now that we can, you know, actually find or get the 5 lists or the rows of the bubble contour, it becomes important to find out that which particular bubble was actually circled by the user. And in order to find that out, we're going to use the concept of masking and bitwise AND together to actually, you know, determine the number of non-zero pixels comprised in that particular image. So we all know the image is binary right now. It is thresholded. So we only have 2 colors, that is black and white. So every region which has the maximum number of black contours, or, you know, makes the largest number of non-zero indexes, if you're talking about it, that particular bubble will be our masked bubble. Considering in mind that logic, we are again gonna iterate each of these sorted contours. Okay, so I take again J, C, they are my 2 variables, and inside of it, I'm gonna pass in the enumerate value of my contours. So for now, they are in the form, the sorted list is from I to I plus 5. So let's take another variable mask and initialize it with a NumPy array. So this array is gonna be consisting of all the zeros in the shape we wanted to. So let's pass in our thresh value and the shape of that particular value alongside a dog type. In our case, we're gonna keep it unit 8. Okay, so after the image is masked, I'm gonna draw the contours around it. So using CV2's draw contours method, I'm gonna pass in the mask, that is this NumPy array which consists of all zeros, and passing in the first contour or whatever contours that it comes out of the loop, and a particular color in which we want the contours to be marked around. So for now, I take -1, -255, and -1. Okay, so now that we have these two things, we need to apply the mask to the threshold image, and after that we need to count the number of non-zero pixels in the bubbled area. Okay, so I take the variable mask, and using, like I said previously, the bitwise AND operator. This is basically used bitwise AND. They are all gate based operators. They are used for image blending and joining up two images in different forms. So I pass in bitwise AND, and I'm gonna pass in my thresh value over here. And they are the two parameters, like on image source, the two images which you want to combine, the first image source and the second image source. And then you need to pass in a mask over here. So since we have it in the form of mask, I'm gonna pass in mask itself. Okay, and now I'm gonna take a variable total. So it is going to count the number of non-zero values inside that particular bubble, all right? So it's gonna start with this contour, okay, loop over it, count, because it's a binary image, you have only two components. So it's gonna count all the white or the black components all together, and every black component would add on to this total color. And we know that whichever among these five bubble have like the maximum range of black contours or non-zero values, because they are represented in binary, that is 0 and 1, that is going to be our selected contour. So total is equals to CV2 dot, I'm going to use a function that is count non-zero, and I'm going to pass in my mask right over here. Okay, so this will count the total number of non-zero values, and now we need to make a check right over here. Okay, if the current total has a larger number of totals or the non-zero values, then we know that that particular contour is the bubbled answer. So we write a statement if bubbled is none. Okay, so that means you are entering this loop for the very first time, and we initialize bubbled as none. So if the bubble is none, or the total of the contours, okay, it is greater than the bubbled first contour, all right? So either of the two conditions, why this one? It is when first time you are iterating over this loop, you come here and you see that it is none. So what are you gonna do? You're gonna take the bubbled value, and here you're gonna pass in your total as well as your j. Okay, so your j is the index or at which number you found that bubble, that is 0 1 2 3 and 4, that we can identify the marked bubble. We need to develop a logic for marking it at the same time. So let me take a variable color, and I'm gonna pass in the RGB values of the circle I want around it, or the color by which I want to mark that answer. And I'm taking another variable, and whichever question we are dealing with, that is the qth value, I'm gonna get the answer for that particular question. Okay, so for the first iteration, for the first row, which one of these is the correct answer. So that is what I got inside this variable k. Okay, and now I'm going to use a if statement that if the correct answer or the kth answer is equal to the answer which the user marked, which is inside the bubbled variable, Okay, so bubbled has basically two values, 0 and 1. So the first value of bubble, that is the answer, or the number by which at which it was marked, that is, you know, A, B and C. We have already discussed how this loop works. That is, if you are entering this loop for the first time, it is going to initialize the value of bubbled with the total number of values in the front gradient and the value of J with the first value. And as soon as we keep on iterating, the value increases. And if we, in the later part, we find another value or another variable which has more non-zero values, it get incremented and it is replaced by this particular value. So now that we have bubble, that means our answer is correct. Okay, so again, I'm gonna initialize my color right over here, and this time it's gonna be two colors, one for right, another one for wrong. So I pass in my RGB values, and I am gonna increment the correct which we initialized above in this code, or the number of correct answers. I am simply gonna initialize it to 1, or increment the value of correct with 1 if this thing is correct. So after initializing, we finally get out of the loop. So basically the correct variable have all the answers, that is the number of correct answer to the total number of questions, that were 5. Okay, so let me just print this thing out, printing the number of correct answers, and yes, there you go. So that's it about this video. Alright, I know there was a lot to take in, right, from finding contours so many times, performing edge detection, everything, and then there was a couple of logic involved at multiple stages, but I hope you understood how this thing worked. This is our image and this is the outer results. We can, you know, further automate it by calculating percentages, or, you know, make it customizable to any other document scanner which we need to build up. So I hope you enjoyed this video. If you did, don't forget to hit the like button, because yeah, it was a lot of efforts which were actually put in while making this video. All right guys, thank you. See you in the next one. Bye bye.